Night fall, but rejoicing comes in the morning.
We're gathered here together this morning for the Thanksgiving service of Dennis Francis. And so I invite us to lift our voices to this wonderful hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Today here in the sanctuary and online to give thanks to God for the life of Dennis Francis. We give thanks to God for the precious memories, the various exchanges we would have had with him. And no doubt his loss creates a gaping hole within the soul, and the emotions at this point in time are raw. This then is a good place to be. For our God is here with us to give comfort, to give us the assurance that he captures our tears in his bottle, and he knows the emotions that we express in a time like this. On behalf of the Webster Memorial United Church, I extend very warm welcome to you, to his family members. And we pray that the songs we sing, the prayers we offer, reflections on God's word today, the moments when we share memories, all will serve to bring comfort and to assure us that indeed on this journey we are not alone. This may be your first time here at Webster, and at some point you may need to use our restroom facilities. You may find these to the rear of our administrative building. If you have your cell phone with you, we ask that you place it in the silent mode that we may worship God undisturbed. This service, for the most part, will flow unannounced. We ask, therefore, that those who are scheduled to participate kindly note where your input will be needed and respond accordingly. May the peace, the presence, the grace of Almighty God be with all of us as we remember Dennis with fondness and as we lift our praises to our faithful God. Warm welcome to all of you.
Good morning. I am Camille Roberts, the granddaughter of Mrs. Kay McGregor, one of Uncle Dennis's six siblings. They are the first of two of the siblings, and they were always quite close. And this morning, I have the honor of reading the tribute that she has prepared on her behalf. Today, it is my privilege to share with you memories of my brother and friend, Dennis Francis. I feel as if I have spent most of my life living with him. We grew up together, and later he came to live with me and spend the rest of his life with my family and I. I consider him more than a brother, a friend, a companion, and as an eighth child to me. Dennis and I are approximately 1 year apart in age, and so we spent much of our young days together and making visits to our granny's house. I remember us going together to Windward Road Government School and Bethany Gospel Hall, and remember him working as a wrapper at Moraine's store on King Street during the school breaks. Because we were the two eldest children, Bibby, our father, would load us on his bicycle and ride us to the Mineral Bath or to Barnett's Beach, all three of us balancing on the bicycle together. Dennis was an avid swimmer, and he would swim and swim and swim. Bibby taught us, both of us, to swim, but I never learned. Dennis was like a fish, and he would swim far out into the waves until he was barely seen, but he always came back okay. At times, he would be missing from the house while we were living at Glasspool Avenue, and we knew that some of these incidents were because he would be off swimming by himself. Dennis also loved babies, and I remember an incident when our mama went to church one evening, only to return and find out Dennis had given her little sister Karen a large mango. It was quite a sight. Even after Dennis came to live with my family, often the babies growing up, Tammy and Camille, would find themselves nestled up in his lap. Dennis came to live with my family and I in 1975 after our parents moved. At first he slept on the living room sofa and later had his own room with an addition that was built just for him. There was some adjustment, but with time, Dennis became an integral part of the family, as well as an established member of the community at 102D Maxfield Avenue. Dennis knew every shop in town and would readily run errands for groceries and to purchase the daily Gleaner and Star newspapers. He is remembered by Camille for walking her to school as a little girl when going to Lanaman's Prep. He endeared himself to everyone in the community and along Maxfield Avenue. He made friends all around and would get special favors from neighbors and had guaranteed safety even during the years of violence and unrest in the neighborhood. He would walk, much to our consternation, at late hours at night. We would be very concerned, but he would always make it home safely. Among his loves, Dennis loved going to see the movies and would go every Sunday night to the Ritz Cinema, no matter what was happening. This gave him a lot of pleasure. He also loved Johnson's Drive-In Chicken and Chips and Pepsi. As much money as he would get, it would be spent on Pepsi. No way of talking him out of it. He also loved muscle books, in particular, Charles Atlas. Who has not been asked by him for muscle books? And who among the family and friends have not heard that name, Charles Atlas? It was so easy to please him. He would also do the workouts he learned in the muscle book. And I remember him doing his exercise, even when he did not feel as strong as he once was. He also loved to play cards in solitaire. And he continued to play cards with his caregivers, Christine, Denise, and Annie, up to very recently. And Dennis gave his life to Jesus. He was sweetly saved and expressed his acceptance of Jesus as the Savior. This occurred while attending church in Macedonia Seventh-day Adventist Church, where he was baptized and later became a member. He continues to be loved and remembered by them. Dennis lived life as an overcomer, beating many odds stacked against him over the years. He overcame rheumatic fever, survived being hit by a bicycle, and all the complications of the injury to his left leg. He survived hospital admissions, medical and surgical procedures, and diagnoses that many others would have succumbed to. He went through it all. One night, following a brief, non-alarming illness, Jesus decided to take my brother home to be with him. Dennis is there with him now, with no pain or limitations, and no doubt happy to have such health and strength, and doing all the workouts he can do, and enjoying without limit all the things that gave him pleasure. Dennis was a nice person and a handsome man, beloved by many, and remembered by all who had the privilege of sharing in his life. And Dennis was my company. Even after all my children grew up and left home, Dennis was my eighth child. Dennis, I miss you. But the Lord was ready to take you home out of the pain and suffering you were going through. You are resting in the arms of Jesus. After all you have been through, you are now home. I will miss you, and so will many others in the family and your friends in the neighborhood. Dennis loved to sing, and we would often sing songs together. And Dennis is not here to sing with me today, but I'm going to sing with one of his favorite singers, Nat King Cole. Because for me, Dennis is unforgettable.
Unforgettable, just what you are. Unforgettable, so near or far, like a song, love that clings to me. How the thought of you just sings to me, never before has someone been more. unforgettable in every way. And forevermore, that's how you stay. Yes, why, darling, it's incredible that someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too. Unforgettable in every way, and forevermore, that's how you'll stay. That's why, darling, it's incredible that someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Colleen Turner McGregor, the wife of Alan McGregor Jr., one of Uncle Dennis's nephew, and I have the privilege of reading his tributes. As we gather here today to honor the memory of my beloved Uncle Dennis, I am moved to reflect on the qualities that defined him in my eyes. Four words describe who he was. Firstly, fit. Uncle Dennis exemplified vitality through his love for walking. He would walk long distances without complaint, a testament to his enduring strength. His daily journeys from our home on Maxfield Avenue to Halfway Tree and back made him well known in our community and were a testament to his fitness. Even at 75, he continued this ritual, inspiring those who knew him, including myself, who marveled at his stamina, knowing I would struggle with a fraction of his endurance. Secondly, consistent. Simple yet unwavering, my uncle's preferences were clear and never changed. No matter what day of the week, month, or year, his choices remained constant. When asked what he wanted, it was either a patty, a Pepsi, or a muscle book. He absolutely loved muscle books, and Charles Atlas was his favorite bodybuilder. Thirdly, devout. Uncle Dennis's unwavering dedication to attending church reflected his deep love and faith in the Lord. Although our family isn't Seventh-day Adventist, every Saturday morning found him in the pews, never missing a Sabbath service. This routine persisted for years until his mobility changed. Despite this, his commitment remained steadfast, and his church, recognizing his devotion, would come to him, ensuring he received communion even in his immobility. This profound act of faith and communion with his spiritual community exemplifies his unwavering devotion to God. Lastly, specific. Uncle Dennis had a precise vision of what he wanted, and he never wavered from it. I recall an incident when my late sister Cherise, aware of his love for Pepsi, brought him a large bottle, only to be gently corrected by Uncle Dennis that he preferred the smaller size bottle. and he never drank it. This attention to detail mirrored his approach to life, deliberate and exacting. During his initial hospitalization in 2015, I realized the depth of my affection for him, akin to a son's love for his father. I remained by his side, ensuring his comfort and well-being. His dependence on me during his final years was a profound reminder of our bond, unspoken yet deeply felt. Today, as we bid farewell to Uncle Dennis at Webster, I'm reminded of some divine orchestrations that we have had. His journey and mine were intertwined through unexpected connections, like my daughter Eliana. Her birth was at Natal Hospital, which is also where he had many hospital stays in his final days. Christine was Eliana's caregiver as a baby. Then 5 years later, she became one of his caregivers. And although we are not members, Eliana was christened right here at Webster by Reverend Carlisle. And here we are today with Reverend Carlisle laying my beloved uncle to rest. All of this speaks to the higher plan that the Lord has for our lives, which is beyond our understanding. While I mourn his absence, I find solace in knowing that Uncle Dennis now rests peacefully, embraced by our Savior. His 85 years were a blessing, and I'm grateful for every moment shared with him. Farewell, dear Uncle Dennis. Your legacy of strength, consistency, devotion, and specificity will forever guide and inspire me.
Dennis's sister, younger sister. Well, my brother Dennis was my beloved brother. And I, first of all, I want to thank you all for being here and for honoring our beloved brother at this time of loss and hope we have in our wonderful Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ. I thank God for my sisters. I thank God for Gail and June and Kay, all of who stood by Dennis in all his time of difficulties and problems and good times too. But they were there for him, especially in the latter years of his life. And I appreciate that. I also remember Junior, my nephew, and his wife, Colleen. They were wonderful. And his caregivers, Annie and Denise and Christine. And I thank them all. And for the wonderful church that he attended. We all appreciated every one of them. Now, my brother Dennis, my mother, first of all, was a woman who liked uncommon things. She liked uncommon dresses and things like that. And in my brother, she got an uncommon son. He was an unusual gift. And first of all, he was unusual in the sense that he had a very special love for muscles, especially muscle books. And over the years, I wondered why he loved muscles. And I thought about it in a lot of ways. But I realized that muscles, we use them and we don't give a thought to them, but they're actually very important. And they're wonderful gifts of God, muscles. They actually give us strength, they give us form, they give us beauty, and they're without them, we would be totally at loss without them. So Dennis taught us one of the things is to appreciate our muscles and their function and their wonderful work in our bodies. And King David in the Psalm, in a wonderful Psalm 139, says it this way, "I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. I will praise thee, for we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knows right well." And this is a wonderful gift that Dennis gave us, to appreciate the wonderful work of God in our muscles.
Thank you. I have one as well. Thank you to my sister who said she was the youngest. I will remind her that Dennis was the eldest child, and I am in fact the youngest, otherwise known as the wash belly. And although there were many years between us, we had a bond that was sealed always with the smile that Dennis would have for me. It is said that a smile can change the world, and Dennis's smile certainly changed mine. From my earliest memories to the last day I saw him, which was only a few days before his death, his infectious smile was donned for me every time I was in his presence. And the smile spoke of the endless love and affection, his kindness, and his indomitable spirit. It is only a smile that you can understand if you have experienced it. As a young child, I was always fascinated by my brother. I was really young, and I would follow him around endlessly. He had patience for me because I loved to listen to him sing. And I would just be fascinated with his singing. And that has led to a lifelong love of the male voice. No offense to women, but I loved his voice and therefore always remembered him when I heard the male voice sing. He loved cricket. You'll hear that again over and over. And he would practice bowling, and I got to watch him as he would, you know, deliver his bowls and cricket. I will not go on to Charles Atlas. I think you all know that now. As I grew older, and he continued to face life challenges, and I had my own, of course. I would visit him even when hospitalized or take him swimming, another one of his loves that you have heard about. And we laughed and talked, but there was always the smile for his baby sister, Pam. As I got older, I grew to appreciate not only the beauty of his smile, but the brilliance of his mind. He often communicated with difficulty as he got older, but if you would just listen carefully and you had patience, you would be treated to the treasure trove of his great memory. Back to that smile as I end. The smile said, "I love you with everything I have." On my last visit, he was prompted to recriminate me for a mistake I had made to his medical equipment. And when teased to recriminate him, he turned to me and he said, "I want to tell Pam, I am so happy to see you. I am so glad to see you." And he donned that winning smile. And if he were here today, I know that he would smile to see the friends, family, those online, and the enormous support. And he would don that winning smile. And I'm telling you that it would change your life.
friends and family, thank you for coming here to bid my brother Dennis his farewell. I'm Gail Francis, and I am one of the sisters.
And I'm just going to carry on what my sister said. Dennis was a gentleman of his time. He was distinguished by his timing and delivery of words. He knew the precise words to use, and he used only short sentences. And he had a posture of intellectual academic pursuit at all times. And speaking, so I will be speaking for my brother, but I will just start this. It's a brief poem that I wrote in memoriam. Write, my brother, write of dangers fought and battles won beyond those mountains over there. Cry aloud from your graves with voices loud amidst the stillness of the ground. Tell brave men, beware of thoughts abroad, this sacred field where life abounds, where debt is life and jumbled thoughts made plain and hurled from memories reclaimed. I am a knight in gallant hair, but captured not by a calm, not fair. I heard a hurling cry amidst the grass and begged a voice, be calm at last. Knights errant who beneath the shield no longer bear a vest betwixt the heart of fair, my shield no longer bear, swords drawn, retracted hair. When in my life I spoke with florid thoughts of winding paths, the gales and storms, hair, musing quietly at last, like Easter blooms bring peaceful glass. There, thoughts made me hide within the fetal curl, cry, cocoon me, I am forlorn. Here, I am nestled again at last with gentle sound of moving glass. Where torrents pass and waves subside, my soul has passed them here and laughed. Beneath the grave, I am not entombed. My soul now free, thoughts flow to you. My brother had schizophrenia, which was diagnosed at a very young age and throughout his life, but he was not defined by his schizophrenia. Thanks. And now this will be followed by a video feed from my brother, Darian Francis. Audio feed by my brother, Darian Francis.
Hello. This is Dennis Neville Warwick, and here is my story. I was born in Kingston, Jamaica, like all of us here mostly. As a young child, there were many things I liked. I liked cricket and played a lot, starting with when we lived with Granny, just up the steep hill till it flattened. Scores of boys would show up and play bowl for bat. My little brother there went with me. Because I was good off-break bowler, I would bat a lot. I liked music. My favorite singers were Billy Eckstein, Bing Crosby, Perry Como, and Nat King Cole. I used to draw a lot, and I swam. At an early age, I had my challenges, which may have affected people around me, but I was a humble person and felt no harm for anyone. The worst times in my life is when I found myself put in a strange place. I was away from my family. I cried a lot on many occasions. It was a time of deep despair for me. Mama came to see me bringing clothes, food, and lots of stuff. Others would also come occasionally. I never understood why I was there with other people I did not know. Glad to be out, I used to roam around and walk long distances, trying to find my way, but eventually understood what my mother was telling me all along about accepting Jesus as my Savior, and about the best place to be is called heaven. Now I'm here. With guess who? Mama, Bibi, and my dear sister Shirley. And I advise you, if you haven't done so yet, to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior and look to the future life where I am. In the last part of my journey, I spent my many years with my lovely sister and Kay and the rest of the family. They protected me and helped me a lot. I had a good life and everything I needed from them and the rest of my brother and sisters. Dear Shirley, Olive, Karen, and Pam. I remember Mama and all of them going to church all the time. I heard Mama always singing and sewing near to Kier. There was a church of Macedonia. I loved going there. Everyone was very nice to me. There was a time of misery of a broken ankle after a bicycle ran into me. That was it. I never could get around anymore and I was in pain trying to move. This persisted for many years, but it did not take away from the incredible care I got from everyone else around me. Then came the time I fell. I went close to death and I survived. I must give great credit to my little nephew, Junior. Junior was my best friend. In my days, I saw the neighbors, God bless them. As always, it was Junior who took me to the hospital where everyone was nice. Praise God for Dr. Olive and Pam during those times and for Karen who spoke to me on the phone a lot. In only a few days, God gave me the strength to recover. While on the hospital bed, they asked me, what do you want to eat? And I said, patties. They laughed, went and got them, and I was happy. And I saw they were happy too. Dennis was back. I was soon back home. With a new life from God, I wanted to survive. I got to see the countryside where Mama grew up, and that was outstanding. I met many people, and they all extended their love to me. I was not well after that, with different challenges, bedridden, but people all who assisted me every day, 24 hours a day. Early one morning, my time came. Jesus wanted me to be up there with Mama, Bibi, and Shirley. And I accept the passage. Now I am totally free of pain and suffering. I will live here for eternity because I believe in Jesus Christ and I accepted him as my Savior. And that's what made it possible. I would say, please, if you have not done so, do so. And I extend my own love for everyone, and I'm at peace. Mama wanted me to send these messages. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels or demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ our Lord. Now please all rise, hold hands, and say, Hallelujah. Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen.
And with that, I'll invite us to remain standing as we put our voices together again. We heard that Dennis was a singer. And I'm sure Dennis would appreciate if you'd work like me, who can't sing, but I make a joyful noise. So if we all here can't sing or make a joyful noise unto the Lord, then I'm sure he will be pleased about that. So we're going to lift our voices and make a joyful noise to some singing of how great thou art.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the words thy hands have made. sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. His son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Let us look to God in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious, loving, merciful God, we praise and adore you. We glorify you and honor your name because you are the King of all kings and Lord of all. We have come together this morning to worship you, even as we give you thanks for the life of Dennis Neville Warwick Francis, merciful God, whose wisdom is beyond our understanding, surrounds all who now mourn the passing of Dennis with your love, that they may not be overwhelmed by this loss, but have confidence in your goodness and strength to meet the days to come. We thank you that you are a God who comforts and reassures your children in a way that gives hope.
thank you, Lord, for the lives Dennis may have impacted. Help us all now, Lord, to hold on to your peace that passeth all understanding. These and other mercies we ask. Through Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen. As we sing the Lord's Prayer, to the Father, hold on to you.
Our Father who art in heaven, holy, holy, holy be thy name. Our Father who art in heaven, holy be thy name. Thy kingdom come on earth, thy will be done on earth. Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. 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 And forgive us our trespasses. And forgive us our trespasses. As we forgive those who trespass against us, forgive us our trespasses. Our Father who art in heaven, holy, holy, holy be thy name. Our Father who art in heaven, holy be thy name. Thy King, do not lead us into temptation. Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from all evil. Deliver us from all evil. And forgive us our trespasses. And forgive us our trespasses. As we forgive those who trespass against us, forgive us our trespasses. Our Father who art in heaven, holy, holy, holy be thy name. Our Father who art in heaven, holy be thy name. Thy kingdom come on earth, thy will be done on earth. Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Amen, amen, amen. Amen, amen, amen. Amen, amen, amen. Amen, amen, amen.
Amen, amen. May I invite us to stand for the responsive reading, which comes to us from Psalm 91 and will be done by Mr. John Thomas, brother-in-law.
Good morning, everyone. Good to see so many familiar faces here. And although this is a sad occasion for all of us who love Dennis, it's also an affirmation of the faith we have that Dennis is alive forever. Reading from Psalm 91, responsive readings. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty.
I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust.
Surely He will save you from the foulest snare and from the deadly pestilence.
He will cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart.
You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day.
Nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday.
1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you.
You will only observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked.
If you say, the Lord is my refuge, and you make the Most High your dwelling,
no harm will overtake you. No disaster will come near your tent.
For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways.
They will lift
you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone.
You will tread on the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent.
Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name.
He will call on me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him.
With long life I will satisfy him and show him my salvation.
Glory be to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, it's now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Friends, we remain standing as we sing now a medley of choruses. And sweet Jesus, what a wonder you are. He never fails me yet, and Daniel God surely will deliver.
Sweet Jesus, sweet Jesus, what a wonder you are. You are brighter than the morning star. Oh, you are fairer, much fairer than the lily that grows by the way. You are precious, more precious than gold. Sweet Jesus, sweet Jesus, what a wonder you are. You are brighter than the morning star. Oh, you are fairer, much fairer than the lily that grows by the way. You are precious, more precious than gold. He never fails me yet. He never fails me yet. Jesus Christ never fails me yet. Oh, everywhere I go, I want the world to know Jesus Christ never failed me yet. He never fails me yet. He never failed me yet. Jesus Christ never failed me yet. Oh, everywhere I go, I want the world to know Jesus Christ never failed me yet. Daniel God surely will deliver. Daniel God surely will deliver. If you only trust in him by faith, Daniel God surely will deliver. Oh, Daniel God surely will deliver. Daniel God surely will deliver. And if you only look to him by faith, Daniel God surely will deliver.
Amen. Amen. May be seated. Friends, I've never heard in all my years as a minister of religion, don't know if Carl has ever heard of it, but I've never seen or heard the remembrance, a call issued for person to accept Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. It's the first I've seen it, I've experienced it at the funeral service. And the song that we sang, the last one, where it says, Daniel God, surely will deliver. What are the other words? If you only look to him by faith, what happened? Huh? So friends, if you are here today and you have not yet accepted Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I want to encourage you. Just look to Daniel God by faith. Take that step of faith and accept Christ as your personal Lord and Savior so you can have an enjoyable life. I often say that it is the best gift you can leave your loved ones, the gift of hope. When you die in Christ, is the best gift ever to leave with your loved ones. So we prepare our hearts now to hear God's word. Scripture readings come to us from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 12. Will be read by Dr. June Francis, sister, and St. John chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. Will be read by Miss Elena McGregor, grandniece. St. John chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. Is John 3:16? Oh, okay.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Ecclesiastes 3, verses 1 to 12. To everything, there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heavens. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what has been planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to get and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to cast away. A time to rend and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. What profit hath he that worketh in that wherein he laboreth? I have seen the travail which God hath given to the sons of men to be exercised in it. He had made everything beautiful in his time. Also, he had set the world in their heart so that no man can find out the work that God maketh from the beginning to the end. I know that there is no good in them, but for a man to rejoice, or a woman to rejoice, and to do good in all of our life. The word of the Lord.
Scripture reading is taken from John 3, verse 19. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. This is the word of the Lord.
Wonderful reading, my sister. Offering will be taken at this time, and the offering will be in aid of the Rolf Grant Redevelopment Project. So I encourage us all to give generously. We will remain seated as we sing, and then we get to the last verse, we stand.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me down to lie. In pastures green, he leadeth me, the quiet waters by. He lives, he lives, he lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, he lives, he lives. He lives within my heart. My soul he doth restore again, and me to walk doth make. Within the paths of righteousness, and for his own name's sake. He lives, he lives, he lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, he lives, he lives, he lives within my heart. Yea, though I walk in death's dark veil, yet will I fear no ill. For thou art with me and thy rod, and staff me comfort still. He lives, he lives, he lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, he lives, he lives, he lives within my heart. My table though has furnished in presence of my foes, my head thou dost with oil anoint, and my cup overflows. He lives, he lives, he lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, he lives, he lives, he lives within my heart. Goodness and mercy all my life shall surely follow me, and in God's house forevermore my dwelling place shall be. He lives, he lives, he lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, he lives, he lives, he lives within my heart.
Let us pray. Gracious God, you are awesome, you are wonderful. You have allowed us the opportunity to give back a portion of your blessing to us, back to you. We ask that you bless these gifts as they are used for the in aid of the Rolf Grant Redevelopment Project. Bless us, O Father. This we pray in your name. Amen. You may be seated.
The Lord be with you. Let us go to him in prayer. Speak your word to our hearts in this moment, O God, that hearing your word, we may draw from you the comfort and the assurance we need for seasons like this. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts together be found acceptable in thy sight. You who are our rock, our refuge, our redeemer. Amen. We just sang one of my favorite psalms. And because I know it's a favorite of yours as well, I'm going to invite you to say it with me. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. A favorite psalm of many. A psalm in which many of us take comfort. A psalm from which many of us receive peace. And there's a protective element about that psalm. It's a psalm that we as boys growing up in Manchester used to recite when we were walking past the graveyard. Psalm 23. It's a psalm uttered by surgeons as they prepare to engage surgery. It's a psalm uttered by those upon whom surgeries are to be performed. Psalm 23. The lips of soldiers utter Psalm 23 as they prepare to go out to war. It's uttered by sailors who ride the tides of oceans far. Psalm 23. We have a love affair with Psalm 23 because it helps us to relax. It gives a kind of assurance. And I'm sure that while Dennis was alive, at some point in his life, he must have uttered Psalm 23. Maybe he did so when he thought about the different experiences of his life. Maybe he did so when he thought about his siblings and the grandchildren of his siblings. Maybe he thought about Psalm 23 when he recognized that his life was ebbing away. But the fact that Psalm 23 occurs in our order of service as a song, and that you and I have just spoken it, is heaven's reminder to you and me of some very important things. And the first thing it reminds us of is the steadfast presence of God. Yes, in the constant flux of life, we have a shepherd whose presence is steadfast. My friends, life is a reality of constant change. As a matter of fact, change is the only constant of this life. With the elapse of time, seasons change. And some changes are gradual and transitional, like your child going through school. Other changes are sudden, immediate, unsettling. And that is what this Psalm 23 highlights. At one moment in life, you are comfortable. You're sitting at the pool of life's refreshing moments. Business is doing well. The children's trust fund is growing steadily. The meadows are lush. You have vibrancy within your body as well as in your soul. And as soon as you're ready to relax and enjoy the scenery of life, it changes. You find yourself going through the valley of the shadow of disease, distress, divorce, death. But what is true about the psalm is true about your life and mine. through all the transitions, through all the changes, one thing remains steadfast and sure, our shepherd. And the songwriter captures it very wonderfully. We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll, fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. The psalm occurs in our service today to remind us that God, who is our shepherd, already knows the terrain that we tread. He knows the uplands of laughter, and he knows the lowlands of disillusionment. Our shepherd, he knows the dales of quiet rest. He knows the ravines of testing and turmoil. Our steadfast shepherd doesn't flinch when the wolves come to attack his flock. He doesn't run when the winds bluster and blow. No, God stands with us. No wonder the psalmist in another place could say, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. Yes, my friends, the mountains of financial security are quaking in these times. The waters of distress are roaring and tumbling and foaming. But we will not fear, because the eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. Family members, friends, life will be different and possibly difficult without Dennis being around. But I invite you to lean on the truth of God's word, that Jesus, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever, will not leave you. He will not forsake you. My friend, there's a truth about God that you and I must never forget. And the truth is this: there is no place where God is not. God is right where we are. And that is the message of Psalm 23. Dennis's sister repeated a portion of Psalm 139 earlier. But there's another place in Psalm 139 that we should hold to. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up into the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there, your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. My friends, our God is a steadfast God. He is steadfast in his love for us. He is unchanging in his nature and unchangeable in his character. He is true to his promises to surround us, to stand with us, to undergird us, to keep us. He is faithful to his commitment to provide for us. He is honorable in his pronouncements and dignified by standing by his declarations. Now, since this is so, you and I must rest in the shadow of the truth that he has carved us in the palm of his hands, and he watches over us with steadfast divine love. Psalm 23, it reminds us of the steadfast presence of our God. But it reminds us of the sustaining presence of our God. I don't know about you, but there's a kind of peace that envelops my soul every time I sing or speak Psalm 23. I wonder how many of us can testify that when we say this psalm, especially in the troublesome moments of our lives, there is an energy that enters the spirit. There's a calming peace that overtakes us. I can testify that that is the truth of my life. That is how God sustains his people. God gives us what we need, right when we need it, in the right doses that we need it. Somebody may ask then, why did this good God allow such a nice person as Dennis to die when other terrible people who we know are still alive. I don't know why God caused Dennis to die. But before you get upset and tune me out, please understand that there are some things in life that we will never understand. And sometimes God may seem silent in the midst of our questions. If I were to be very honest with you, and I guess I need to be because I'm a pastor and I'm in the pulpit, there are times when I used to interpret God's silence as indifference. There were times when I used to interpret God's silence as absence. But I've come to appreciate that God's silence is neither absence nor indifference. God speaks, but not necessarily in audible ways to the ears or in manners that meet our immediate demands. God speaks deep down inside of the soul. And something somehow reminds us that we are not alone. Something on the deep inside says to us, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. A sweet, deep voice within your spirit reminds you that the God of Jacob is your refuge. My friends, that is the sustaining presence of God. It is a cool drink of peace in times of turmoil. It is a fresh slice of mercy for the wounded soul. It is a juicy peg of calm in the midst of calamity. It is an umbrella of grace over the head of the weary traveler. My friend, take this consolation. We have a sustaining presence. And so as Christians, we can declare in the midst of our turmoil, in the midst of our grief, in the midst of our questions, everything is going to be all right because everything is in the hands of God. Psalm 23 is a wonderful psalm. It reminds us of the steadfast presence of God. It reminds us of the sustaining presence of God. But it reminds us of the sovereign presence of God. No matter who you are, when you come to the last moments of your life, we're faced with the fact that we're not in charge. It doesn't matter how many people you rule. It doesn't matter the number of persons who report to you. It doesn't matter how much money I have. It doesn't matter how much power I wield. It doesn't matter the extent of my educational acumen, my intellectual depth. When my head hits a dying pillow, I come to the understanding that ultimately I am not in charge. God is in charge of life. All the experiences, all the events of life are subject to God's authority. And the truth of this Psalm 23 is that nothing can happen to us without God's knowledge or without God's approval. God is sovereign, and even then, his desire is not to destroy us, but to work his purposes out. So when David says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, he was affirming that when you and I humbly serve God as our sovereign keeper and as our sovereign king, despite the issues of life that cause travail and tears, our sovereign shepherd will ensure that ultimate good is experienced. David was saying that although as wayward sheep we are deserving of God's wrath, although as wayward sheep we are deserving of God's judgment, God gives us mercy instead of condemnation. He offers us grace to cleanse our guilty conscience. David is reminding us that the sovereignty of God is such that he is determined to take us through the valley of the shadow of death over to the other side, where we dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And this is what he has done in Jesus Christ. Yes, my friends, it is God's desire to take each of his children home to be with him in glory. And absolutely nothing will stop God from doing so. That is why we as Christians, and as I'm sure Dennis would have at some point sung, what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. Through Jesus Christ, we see the sovereignty of the shepherd manifested. When Jesus died on the cross of Calvary, the power of sin had to yield to his sovereignty. When Jesus Christ rose from the dead, the power of death had to yield to his sovereignty. When Jesus ascended into heaven, the whole earth had to yield to his sovereignty. When Jesus returns again in glory, all creation will have to bow to his sovereignty. So whether we like it or not, Jesus is Lord over all. Maybe I should ask you, have you made this steadfast, sustaining, sovereign God the Lord of your life? Is it well with your soul? We assemble today and we rejoice with Dennis, not just because he was a good man, but because he was a saved man who has a hope of resurrection and eternal life in Jesus. He took hold of this shepherd's hand. See, Dennis knew that it is good to know Psalm 23 by heart, but it is better to have the shepherd rule our heart. For Dennis was ensuring that on that great day, he will hear from the lips of his heavenly Father, "Well done, good and faithful sheep of mine. Enter the joy of your shepherd." Should you pass on today? Should you pass on this weekend? Should you pass on next week? Would it be well with your soul? May God grant us grace to hold on to the steadfast, sustaining, sovereign God, so that when our eyes close in death, others will be able to sing with certainty, "It was well with his or her soul." Amen.
I invite us to stand as we repeat to say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty.
From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Last night I lay sleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and sing, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. And then methought my dream was changed, the streets no longer ran. Hushed with the glad hosannas, the little children sang. The sun grew dark in mystery, the morn was cold and chill, as the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. As the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, hark, how the angels sing, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. Once again, the scene was changed, new earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on its streets, the gates were open wide. And would might enter, and no one was denied. No need of moon or stars by night, or sun to shine by day. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. Jerusalem, sing, for the night is o'er. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna forevermore. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna forevermore.
Wonderful hope of life evermore in Jesus Christ, that new Jerusalem. There's a sense in which Dennis has drawn us into his family. And so I'm going to ask that we just hold each other's hand, if we're comfortable enough, as we go to God in prayer at this time. Let us pray. God of grace, we thank you that you sent your Son Jesus to break the power of death and bring life and immortality to light through the gospel. He shared our life, took up on himself our death, and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Look not on us, but on us as found in him, and safely bring us through the judgment to the joy and peace of your presence. Loving Father, you hold all souls in life. We praise you for those who have shared this earthly life with us and have entered into eternal life with you. Especially we thank you for Dennis Neville Warwick Francis, for all that you gave him and accomplished in him, for all that made him special, all that he meant to those who knew and loved him. We pray in a special way that you will allow for precious memories of him to be buoyantly present in our lives as we remember him with fondness. Now we thank you, God, that for Dennis, all pain and suffering are ended, that death itself is conquered. Help us to release him into your care and keeping in the confidence that all life finds its fulfillment with you in the joy of your eternal kingdom. We commend to you those who will miss Dennis most in the days to come because they loved him best, especially his siblings, nieces and nephews and grandnieces and grandnephews, all members of his family, all friends. Grant that casting every care on you, they may know the consolation of your divine love. God of all comfort, in the midst of pain, we ask that you heal us with your love. In the darkness of sorrow, shine upon us as the morning star. Awaken in us the spirit of mercy, that as we feel the pain of others, we may share with them the comfort we receive from you. Bring us all at the last with all your people into the kingdom of your glory, where death itself is ended and every tear is wiped from every eye. To you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all glory now and for all eternity. Amen and amen. I invite you, if you're able, to please stand as we commend the soul of our brother to the mercy of God, our Maker and our Redeemer. Let us pray. gracious God, by your power you gave us life, and in your love you are giving us new life in Jesus Christ. We entrust Dennis Neville Warwick Francis to your safekeeping in the faith of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who died and rose again to save us and to bring us all to a joyful resurrection and the glory of your eternal kingdom. Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord, and may light perpetual shine up on him. We pray through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Friends, please remain standing just for brief instructions and a benediction. After this service, we are invited by the family for a brief time of fellowship in our church hall, which is to your left. We will leave these grounds at approximately 12:40 as we make our way up to the Hope United Church for the interment of Dennis's ashes. During the singing of the recessional hymn, the platform party will lead, followed by the family member bearing the urn, followed by family members, and then others of us. Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the blessed Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. We leave singing our faith with this wonderful hymn, Lord of the Dance. I danced in the morning when the world was begun, and I danced in the moon and the stars and the sun, and I came down from heaven. And I danced on the earth. At Bethlehem, I had my birth.
I danced in the morning when the world was begun, and I danced in the moon and the stars and the sun, and I came down from heaven and I danced on the earth. At Bethlehem I had my birth. Dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you all. Wherever you may be, and I lead you all in the dance, said he.
I danced for the scribe and the Pharisee, but they would not dance, and they wouldn't follow me. I danced for the fishermen, for James and John. They came with me, and the dance went on. Dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you all. Wherever you may be, and I lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on the Sabbath and I cured the lame. The holy people said it was a shame. They whipped and they stripped and they hung me on high, and they left me there on a cross to die. Dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you all. Wherever you may be, and I lead you all in the dance, said he.
I danced on a Friday when the sky turned black. It's hard to dance with the devil on your back. They buried my body and they thought I'd gone. But I am the dance and I still go on.
Dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you all. Wherever you may be, and I lead you all in the dance, said he.
They cut me down and I leapt up high. I am the life that